This is Cine Opera House as we know it today, but we were a couple hours away from having this building instead. It's pretty frightening for people who like design and architecture because the building we know today became such a symbol of creativity, a symbol of what a great architecture can be, and it shows the world that a building can be more than just a piece of concrete. But the only reason this building became a reality instead of this one, it's thanks to this guy. And this guy wasn't the architect of the Cine Opera House. He was the jury member that literally saved the design we know today from the rejected pile, and therefore allowing an unknown designer to become a worldwide recognized architect. And what's fascinating about this story, the story I'm going to tell you, is that he saved this particular design for the most selfish reason you can think of. So let's get into it. Welcome to Architect on Steroids, the channel that shows you how to win architectural projects using famous architects' techniques. And today we are going to see how Jorn Utzon won the competition for the Cine Opera House despite being an unknown designer and despite competing against more than 200 other architects. And looking back, you'll see that pretty much anyone could have won this competition also if he or she decided to use the technique I'm going to show you today. And it's not about using some magic, it's just about using logic. And to understand that, we need to travel and go back in Australia in the mid-50s. This time was a transforming period for the country whose economy was rapidly expanding. And after World War II, this newly optimistic nation was looking to define itself. And what's best to define yourself than creating a symbol? The same way the Eiffel Tower is a symbol of France, the Australian Prime Minister wanted a symbol for his country. So he decided that it was going to be the future Cine Opera House. And the Prime Minister, who had big hopes for this project, released an international architectural competition open to pretty much anyone. You just needed to be an architect. So the stakes for this project were very high, both for the potential winner, with a chance to go from unknown to a famous designer, and for the Prime Minister, as he put his reputation into this future symbol for his country. Meanwhile, as the competition was being announced and on the other side of the world, an unknown Danish architect just turned 38. He was barely recognized in Denmark but still decided to participate in this international competition. Why not? So he set to work in his office in the north of Copenhagen, and after some weeks working on his concept, he sent his 12 drawings to Cine just before the competition closed in December. And keep in mind that this was long before the days of email. He actually had to send the physical blueprints to Australia's capital. And what for sure Utzon didn't know was that 222 architects all over the world had decided to do the same thing. Even the Australian Prime Minister didn't expect that many projects. So the chances of success were very low. But anyway, after all the drawings had been received, the judges of the competition had together for 10 days in order to review all the designs and pick a winner. So four men were selected as jury members. The first three were architects only known for their conventional design in the UK and Australia, and none of them is actually known today. And the fourth was different. It was Eero Saarinen, who at the time was a very famous architect and designer, and is still very well known today, in part for his pieces of furniture, like these chairs. So, Eero Saarinen was by far the most influential jury member due to his fame in the world of architecture and design. But judging began in January 1957 without him. He was busy working on personal architectural projects. Therefore, the jury started making a shortlist of 10 designs they liked, but Jorn Utzon's design wasn't one of them. But Eero Saarinen eventually showed up a couple of days after, and when he arrived, he was very disappointed because he saw that the jury already selected a shortlist of projects without waiting for him. And the worst part was that he didn't like any of them. They weren't very creative and not bold enough for him. So he went to his own desk and asked to see the rejected entries, since he wasn't going to choose any of the shortlisted projects. So eventually saw Utzon's blueprints, and he was in love with this design. It was mind-blowing to him. He was so in love with it that he decided to take the design out of the trash pile and exclaimed that it was easily the winner for this competition. And since he was the natural leader of the group, he made everyone agree that this was the right design for the Sydney Harbour. And when you think about it, the world of architecture should thank Hirosanen for saving Utzon's design, because the other projects were far less bold and they wouldn't have led to an iconic structure. Just take a look at the first, second and third option the jury chose before Utzon arrived. And if you want to imagine what it would have looked like, a guy took the time to transform these drawings into 3D renderings. So this is the result. It looks better, but we are still far from the iconic building we know today. So now you're probably thinking, okay, this is a cool story, and it is. But what are the takeaways? What can I learn from this? Just design something I like and hope that a jury member will luckily pick it up from the rejected pile? Well, no, it's not my message here. Let me show you something. So this is Utzon's official blueprints for the Sydney Opera House, right? We are all now very familiar with this structure. But at the same time as the Opera House competition, Hirosanen, the main influencer in the judging group, was designing what would become his most famous building, the TWA passenger terminal in New York's airport. And his drawing looked like this. Let's put the two blueprints together. So did you notice anything? Any similarities? Well, let's look at some more and see the interior of the two buildings now. So this is Utzon's blueprints for the interior of the Sydney Opera House. And let's compare it to Sanyan's design for the TWA interiors design. Are you seeing it now? Well, let's bring everything together and look at the completed project as a whole. On the left, the Sydney Opera House, and on the right, the New York City Airport. The similarities between both designs are striking. The white triangle's curved shape, trying to reach the sky, the glass part in the middle, and just the overall look. There is a lot of similarities. And it's even more puzzling knowing that at the time, Utzon was only known for designing brick houses in Denmark that look far from the Sydney Opera House style we know today. But in reality, I don't know if Utzon was aware of Sanyan's project in New York, so I don't know if he copied intentionally Sanyan's style in order to increase his chances of winning. Jorn Utzon only said he had initially entered the competition to design Sydney's Opera House to exercise his ideas, and he said he was surprised to learn he had won. So probably didn't copy anyone, it was just a case of the right time and the right place, or look, depending how you want to look at it. But whatever the intention of the designer was, what is for sure is that he won this specific competition because his design looked like the most influential jury member style. This is for sure, it cannot be random, because look at this other famous example. So this is not Australia anymore, this is Paris, and the building we see is Paris Modern Art Museum, also called Centre Pompidou. Some of you may know that this building was the first masterpiece of two of the best architects of the last century, Richard Rogers and Renzo Piano. But what you probably don't know is that the reason this specific building got selected out of more than 600 projects is exactly the same as the Sydney Opera House. The two architects' project had a style that appealed to the most influential jury member. In this case, it was the head of the jury, who was Jean Prouvé. Jean Prouvé was a well-known French designer that started his career as an iron worker before to make his own pieces of furniture, made of iron of course. And then he moved on to architecture with this idea to design buildings and houses using prefabricated metal structures. So he thought a lot about metal and how you can make the most of this material, and he drew hundreds of sketches to find the best metal constructive principles. So when the two young architects proposed their vision for a 6-floor building made of prefabricated metal elements and using constructive principles that would be visible by the public, Jean Prouvé was astonished. It was the building of his dreams. So of course he did everything he could to make this project win. It was almost like a logical follow-up of his own work. And to show my point here, look at the model Jean Prouvé was working on just 1 year before the competition started. So this is the model he was working on. And now look at the model made for the Modern Art Museum. It looks pretty similar to me. And if you look at the inside, you can even see the connection between the bright colors Jean Prouvel liked to put on his structure and the colors the two young architects put on the technical pipes. And the list of similarities goes on, with beams that looks like one of Jean Prouvel's drawings, with the fact that the second most influential jury member was also known for his work on light iron structure. But I'll stop here because I think you see the point. But you might be thinking that the takeaway here is to find out about the most influential jury member style and to copy it in order to win the project. But it's not what I'm trying to get across here, because I believe you wouldn't be happy copying someone else's style. It's not particularly creative, it's not very ethical, and in the long term, your portfolio of projects is not going to make any sense. It's just going to look like a scrapbook from different architects. And you will look like an inconsistent designer, and we don't want that. So what am I trying to say here? Because we haven't gone through all these stories for no reason, don't worry. There is a useful lesson here that you can use for your own project and your own career. Rather than entering every competition or opportunity to get your work built, it is better for you to choose the projects you want to compete in. Let me explain. If you want to apply the strategy we just learned, you should decide what project to pursue depending on who is judging them. If you know a particular jury or client that is more prone to choose a design that has your style, go for it, because it will mean that you will be ahead of other architects without doing anything. Because other architects probably have a good style, a great style, but it just won't match what the client wants. You know, it's like if tomorrow you want to open a Mexican restaurant because you know how to cook great Mexican food. You should target a neighborhood in which you know they like Mexican food and where they will enjoy your work. Makes sense, right? Well, it's exactly the same thing here. Only choose battles that you know you can win. This way, you're going to increase by far your chances of success without having to copy anyone and being true to yourself. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this video interesting, and I would love to know how you are going to apply this technique for your own projects. And remember, if you want to see more of this type of content, please give me a like, subscribe, and click the bell so you don't miss the next videos.